Okay, so Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So today our topic is moral obstacles and understanding truth. This topic is very important, and normally, according to my experience in different centers and places, people don't know about this normally. And sometimes we are doing a lot of mistakes because of this issue. So, but our general topic normally, for the last several lectures I have already delivered, is related to morality and ethics in the Quran. So this is also the part of our, the general title, Moral and Ethics in Quran. So today I would like to talk on this issue especially, that this is a specific and special approach which is mentioned in the Quran. So sometime we say that, yes, we accept that this is the truth, there may be two aspects. One is related to our knowledge, related to, for example, our logical grounds, and then intellectually we understand that you are right, so it's okay. But sometimes we don't understand. You say, why you don't understand truth? Why you don't understand that I'm right, I'm on right path? So this is what we have this issue now in our society. In religious societies and in other societies, that we are, or normally we are coming across this issue, that some people are claiming that we are right, other people are not accepting them. So this is the biggest issue now. So sometimes we have, when we say that we don't understand or we don't accept that this is a truth or this is a reality or this is a fact, this is because of our academic issue, because of our logical grounds. We are lacking something. For example, we don't have enough information. You are talking to me, you are speaking to me, and again, I don't accept that you are saying you are right or wrong. Your statement is true or false. So then, this is why then you have to provide more information. So I don't have any prejudice attitude. I don't have any enmity. I like to accept if this is truth. But I have lack of logical arguments. I have lack of information or maybe knowledge. Or you are not providing enough knowledge to me. Maybe this is from my side and maybe from your side. But this is one aspect that, but sometimes this is very interesting, that we don't have any knowledge problem. We don't have academic problem. We have logical grounds. And we 100%, we are certain that you are right. You are true. Your statement is true. But again, I don't accept it. The issue is that, why I am not accepting it? When there is not a logical problem, there is not a philosophical problem or intellectual problem, all the information has been provided. For example, you are sitting in front of me, and then I know that this is true, this is right, that you are sitting in front of me, this is reality. So I am certain, but again, I am not going to accept it. So to admit the truth, sometime our problem is moral. Sometimes our problem is our interests. Sometimes our, for example, our prejudice attitude or maybe any other reason which is related to our heart, which is related to our soul, which is related to our mindset. Because we have a particular mindset, because of this mindset, we are not ready to accept. So even in different, there are different religions now. Even Christianity and Judaism and Buddhism, and even in between Shia, there are Ahl Sunnah, there are Shia and other groups, there are schools of thought. Again, we have this issue. Sometimes we have affiliated ourselves, we have some interest there. So we are not ready to learn the truth because of our moral and ethical aspect, not intellectual or logical aspect. So now I will again summarize this, that before going ahead and then see the next slide, Just so sometimes we don't accept truth or we don't understand truth because of our knowledge problem, lacking knowledge, lacking maybe logical grounds, and but sometimes we don't have any academical problem. So we have all information, everything is good, even we have reached to certainty that you are right. Again, I am not accepting this. So why? What is the matter? So let's see what I wrote. I forgot. Okay, this is the topic is reasons for denying truth. One I mentioned here that logical aspect. First of all, we are discussing logical aspect, and now I am going to read it. Sometimes we have lack of knowledge or logical grounds, and thus we don't understand truth. So if we increase our knowledge, information, and get to know the logical grounds of a truth being presented to us, we will not have any problem to accept and admit the truth. So this is one point that I have already explained for you. The second thing is, again, second slide is also related to logical aspect. So your proposition means your statement. For example, I say that there is a sun outside, for example. So okay, this is a statement. You have to verify this. You have to confirm this. You will go outside, you will say this is, there is a day, there is a sun, for example. You will say what I am saying, so you have verified this. You have confirmed this. Then you will say that yes, I am right. Then you will say that my statement is true. So when we are talking about proposition in Arabic and in Persian, we say it qaziya. This is a qaziya, basically. So your proposition should be verifiable with the reality. This is logical aspect. Whatever I am saying, it must be verifiable. If you are not going to verify, then it is false. It is not true. And your statement should be capable of verification that can be proved to be true or according to the actuality. So this is clear. Now, the third slide is about moral aspect. Now we have already finished logical aspect because this was not my topic. And if you had any question about this logical aspect, then you can ask this question. But I am not going to, maybe you may have a lot of questions about truth. What is the essence of truth? What is the meaning of truth? So we may have another lecture on this topic. But here I'm not going to explain in my lecture that what is truth. So this is another issue, and we may proceed another time. So the moral aspect is, sometimes we don't have logical or intellectual problems in understanding truth. We don't have lack of information or knowledge. Rather, we have moral and ethical problems in admitting truth. Our mindset, personal interests, specific behavior, moral viciousness, and mischievous attitude enforce us to deny the truth. Is it clear? Okay. Questions? Okay, then it's clear, yeah? Okay. So, now I would like to just mention some Quranic verses. Because it is very important for me just to find out exactly what Quran is saying, whether Quran is also that accepting and acknowledging what I am saying or not. So this is why it is very, very important. So now this is Quranic verse, and this is from Surah Luqman, verse number 7. وَإِذَا تُتْلَى عَلَيْهِ آيَاتُنَا When our communications or our verses are recited to them, Quran says, وَلَّا مُسْتَكْبِرًا They turn back from these verses. مُسْتَكْبِرًا While they are feeling proud because of their takabbur, because of their proud, feeling proud. Because of their, you can say, arrogance. So they are arrogant, and when we are reciting our verses on them, so they are just turning back and don't accept this. because of their istikbar. So what is takabbur? Takabbur is nothing to do with your intellectual aspect. Takabbur is nothing to do with our logical aspect. This is related to our behavior, our akhlaq, our morality. So Quran clearly saying that the problem is not in their, for example, academic, but problem is ethical. So they feel proud, they feel that we are respectful, we have dignity, and if we accept the truth, then this is insulting for us. This will degrade us. And again, for example, if you are saying something, and I accept that you are right, so it is not enough. When I'm accepting that you're right, then you have some obligations. When you're saying to me that I'm accepting that, yes, you're right, then I have to accept some obligation. If I'm denying you, then I have no obligation at all because I don't accept you. So one of the reasons that we are denying truth, this is because we are we don't want to perform our duties to get rid of these obligations. So for example, if God is saying something, we will deny it. Why are we denying? Not because of our, we have knowledge problem, or because we don't want to, fulfill our duties and perform our duties and obligations. So we want to escape from the commandments of God. So this is one Quranic verse. This is a beautiful, let's see that another, there is another Quranic verse again. Just pay attention to this Quran verse. Quran says in Surah An-Naml, verse number 14, وَجَّهَدُوا بِهَا. What is the meaning of وَجَّهَدُوا بِهَا? وَجَّهَدُوا بِهَا, that they denied them, they denied it. And then وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ, while they were certain of truthfulness. So you see what Quran is saying, this is totally contradictory. Apparently, this is a contradiction between certainty and denial. So they are at denial stage. So is it possible? I really not easy to understand that you have yaqeen, you are certain that this is truth, but again you are denying. Quran is saying that وَجَّهَدُوا بِهَا, they are denying, وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا, while they knew, they know, and they have certain, they have reached to the certainty that yes, they have confirmed themselves. It is quite clear for them that it is right. So, again, in this Quranic verse, you see, Zulman wa uluban. This is a reason why they are denying this. Quran says because of those two reasons. One reason is Zulman, because of their oppression. Because of their zulm, because they are oppressing themselves, because they want to be oppressor, they want to transgressor. And second is for uluvan, they want to, because of their takabbur, because of their proud, because they think that we are superior to others, we have superiority. So because of this superiority, they are denying the truth. But they have they are certain, if you ask them that why you are, so logically they don't have any problem. Their knowledge is okay, their information is okay, everything is good, but again denying, why you are denying? So this is the beautiful aspect from Quran. So, فَنْزُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. So, and they denied them unjustly and proudly. Two words Quran used, unjustly and proudly. Okay. So, just this is the same slide, I mean that in different ways I just explained this. An arrogant behavior and feeling proud is considered here as a moral obstacle in the way of accepting truth. It means that sometimes knowledge and awareness doesn't help us in accepting truth because moral barrier, which is related to our heart, refrain us to do so. And essentially, an arrogant person assumes that his dignity and his honor or his superiority is greater than admitting truth. So they have two realities. One is they have to admit that this is a truth. Another thing is their own personality. Now they compare both things. They think that if I accept your truth, then I have my personality. So this is above them to accept this truth. So this is the aspect Quran here mentioned. Now, again, ethical aspect of arrogant behavior is applied on those who do not submissive to the truth. Their heart takes stand against the knowledge, and their sentiments and emotions resist against truthfulness. So you know that we have a thinking aspect, we have a emotional aspect, we have feelings, we have behavior. So emotionally and their sentiments and everything, they resist against the truth. But thinking aspect is okay. So intellectually, they cannot resist. For example, you are sitting in front of me. So I know that I cannot resist. But how I accept that, this fact that you are sitting? This is sometimes, this is happening in us. This is the, we have to say that human is like this. So we need to understand about ourselves. Why it is too much emphasized in different Ahadith and Quran that marfatun nafs. What is the meaning of marfatun nafs? Marfatun nafs mean that we have to understand ourselves. We should understand our potentials. We should understand our what are our powers. We should understand our strengths. If we don't know about our strengths, if we don't know that what is our potential, then we cannot set our goals. We don't have any objectives. So if we, everyone has goals, you have goals, you have goals, you have goals. But depending, sometimes your goals are very limited, because your goals are limited to this world only. Your goals are not higher than what you want, because of your understanding about yourself. So marfatun nafs, this is not our topic, but another day maybe, so we'll just take up this topic also. So this is why, what Quran is saying in my Bible, even I was not able to bring some statements from Bible. So in the last moment I talked to one of the great scholars here, Christian scholars, and we have a discussion program every week, comparison between Quran and Bible. And I talked to them and I'm going to give this presentation. So please give me a two or three statements from Bible. So he totally confused that what I'm saying. I said, oh, okay, you understand what I'm saying? And he understood. But he promised me that he will send something, but he didn't till now. So maybe next time I will be able to, or I will research myself. But I think that there must be something in other divine books. So this interesting issue is, we can see here, that marfatun nafs is very important, and Quran is basically emphasizing on different aspects of understanding of our soul and heart and human as a whole. So then they can be apparently humble but ethically arrogant. Sometimes it is very difficult. If a person is arrogant and he's feeling proud, then but maybe practically he's a good person. And practically, he is very humble to you. He is very submissive to you. But there is a proud inside. He may manifest this any other time. But again, sometimes physically, they are also manifesting this proudness. So, in both cases, whether this person is physically also showing this feeling of proud or not, in both cases, the problem is in heart. This is the main cause or the root cause of his behavior. So if there is a behavioral problem, the behavioral problem comes from the heart and his how he has been nurtured or whatever it is. So there is a very good hadith I would like to quote, that there was a person who was praying. When he was praying, the Prophet Muhammad saw that he is playing with his beard. He was just playing with his beard while praying. Then he said very beautiful thing, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He said, I just mentioned it in Arabic, لَوْ خَشَعَ قَلْبُهُ. If his heart was humble, if his heart was refined, if his heart was purified, لَخَشَعَتْ جَوَارِحُهُ, his body parts would have also followed his heart. So you see that how much this is beautiful. You have problem in your actions or in practice, this is because of your heart. So if you were humble, if you were your purified person and you are ethical and everything, then according to this hadith, then we would not see in practice what you are saying or playing with beard or whatever. So you have a problem of basically humbleness of your heart. So there is another hadith, and again the topic is same, moral aspect. So we are basically working on moral aspect only, not logical aspect. So that truth is also denied, there is another reason. So why we deny truth? One aspect is related to intellectual, so we have already just discussed or mentioned and pointed out. And one aspect is related to, we said about moral. Another thing also related to moral is sometime we want to follow majority of the people. Because majority is saying something, then we say that, oh, so we will accept what majority is saying. So this is totally, this kind of behavior is misleading for us. It can mislead us towards a wrong place. So what Quran is saying, Quran says, truth is also denied due to our non-academic behavior. For example, we develop an attitude to follow the way of majority of the people. This kind of aptitude can mislead us and divert our attention from the right path. So now see this Quranic verse. وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This is, if you obey the majority of those on earth, if you obey the majority of those on earth, they will make you lose the way of Allah. This is what, وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُزِلُّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ إِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الزَّنَّ. Then Quran again saying, يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الزَّنَّ, that when you, oh, what is the problem? For example, you may ask this question. Okay, when majority is saying something, if there is kind of consensus, then why we should not follow it? Quran is saying that because sometime, if you want to accept truth, if you are already adhered to truth, then you must have reached to the certainty, yaqeen. If you are certain, then you should accept it. But when you are following the majority of the people, so most of the time or sometimes what happens, basically you are following your assumption, you are assuming, this is zan, this is guman, this is just your, this is just estimate, so this is not 100% yaqeen. So logic and philosophy is important for you. For example, all of you are sitting here and you are saying something, and I can differ you, I can disagree with you. Why? Because I have my arguments, I have my logic. So this is again what Quran says, that sometimes we deny truth because of following the majority of the people. Please take your seat. Okay, so again we will continue. The next, another reason is why we don't truth, because of our forefathers, because of our parents. So our parents are there because of our environment, because of our circumstances. So everyone has his own circumstances, surroundings. So everyone has nurtured in certain way. So now I will say, I have seen several cases, you also know, maybe because you say that there are children and they have grown up, but they are defending their parents blindly. So the blind attachment is the most dangerous thing in the humanity. So blind attachment should not be there. If, for example, you are Muslim, you are Shia, you are Sunni, you are whatever you are, so you have reached to the certainty. You should have solid arguments about your beliefs, set of your beliefs. If you don't accept these, then for example, your word Quran is saying, "Inna wajadna abana." We have found our fathers on a certain way. So this is the way of our forefather. This is the way of our old generation. So we have to follow this, and we are following their footprints. Inna wajadna abana ala ummatin wa inna ala atharihim muqtadun. Their footprints, we will adopt and follow their way. So this is another aspect Quran mentions here. Now, this Quranic verse is very beautiful. Quran again says, I will just translate for you. Ayahsebul insan allan najma izamhu. Does man think that we will never reassemble his bones in the day of judgment? So we will gather your bones also. Why can we not do so? Why we cannot do so? Why? And while we are able to rest even his fingertips perfectly, even in the day of judgment, we will be resurrected. So we will have the same fingertips also. Very interesting. Quran is saying that why you have doubt, why you are doubting or suspecting our potential power or strength, that we cannot return you, we cannot bring you back in the day of judgment once you have died in this universe. So Quran says that well, qadirina ala an nusawwi banana, your fingerprints will also be printed there. So the same person is there. Bal, the last verse, this is 5, 3, 4 and 5. The last point, portion of this Quranic verse is very beautiful. Now Quran says, so they are doubting, they are suspecting, they are not accepting this truth, and they are objecting us, they are criticizing us. They think that we can, no, they don't have any problem. They understand we can do this. They understand our power. But the problem is there. Quran says that yuridul insanu layafjura amamahu, because they want to violate the rules, because we want to continue our transgression and oppression. We want to, and several times it happens. I don't know, you may have your own experience that sometimes it is happening with me. Okay, if I, for example, I will give another example. I said to someone, we were talking, that he wanted to go for Hajj and he wanted to perform. I said, why you are not happy? That you are going to Hajj, you should be happy that you are going to perform Hajj. Then I said myself, I was just joking to him basically, but there was a reality also. I said, because you know, you are thinking that, oh, if I go to Hajj, then when I return back, then I cannot continue this life. I have to again commit the same sins. So this is why you are not happy. So really it is happening in our life. Several times we don't accept the truth. We don't accept what Quran is saying, what Prophet is saying, what God is saying, because we are habitual of our existing life. We are already, or maybe the lustful life, or whatever we can say. Sometimes we want to attach ourselves with this world. Worldly desires are there. These desires don't allow us to accept the truth. So this is another aspect. So this is what I would like to say about Shaitan, about Iblis. Do you know, he was a great theologian. Iblis was a philosopher. He was better than me and you. Okay, you say, I will say, okay, do you believe in God? You will say, yes, we believe in God. I will say, do you believe in Day of the Judgment? You will say, yes, we believe. I will say, do you believe in prophecy, prophetic mission, prophecy and the Nubuwwah? You will say, yes. Then I will say, can you give the arguments? Can you prove that there is a God, existence of God? You will say, yes, we can prove it. But I will say that Shaitan is more strengthful. He was better than me and you. he would know that how to prove the existence of God, because he was experiencing at that time. You cannot compare understanding with your experience. Experience is the highest level of yaqeen, if you are experiencing something. So he was not only, he knew or he would know that about the God exists, he was experiencing the majesty of God. And he again said that he also would believe in prophets, he also would believe in the day of judgment. How we can say this? See what he's saying. قَالَ رَبِّ فَأَنزِرْنِي إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. That, O my Lord, respect me till the time when they are raised. Give me a muhlat. Give me a time till the day of judgment. So what does it mean? It means that he would know. He would believe in the day of judgment. If he didn't know, then how he could say this? If Shaitan is saying that, oh Allah, give me the time and muhlat and time to the day of, till the day of judgment, it means that he has a faith upon it. And then he's saying that illa ibadaka minhum al-mukhlaseen, I will have no access to those who are purified. Who are purified? We are not purified. Prophets are purified. So it means he also would believe in these the group of people who are prophet. So now he has no theological problem. But again, he denied the truth. Why? Quran says, because of his arrogance, because of his takabbur, he was not able to accept and admit the reality. So these Quranic verses are very beautiful, that saying to us, and that sometimes we have a moral problem, ethical problem, for not admitting and accepting the truth.
We have a laptop.
Do we have time? Finish?
No, I mean we have a laptop. They have
oh, you have a laptop. Oh, very good. I will be thankful if you can.
Okay, we will connect this.
So, this is what Iblis said. قَالَ رَبِّ فَانْزِرْنِي إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يُبْأَسْهُمُ وَإِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمْ الْمُخْلَسِينَ مُخْلَسِينَ. So this is related to that he doesn't have any theological problem or whatever it is, but because of this feeling of proud and arrogant behavior, so he didn't accept the truth at that time. Now this is a question for you, not for me. So, what is this? How one can understand whether he or she has a logical problem in understanding truth? Does Iblis from the beginning he knew that he has a feeling of proud? This is a very beautiful question. So, anyone from you can answer this? So, just to, because we are running out of time, just to let you know that another beautiful aspect of today's topic is that sometime, interestingly, we don't understand that we are denying the truth because of our, we are hiding something, because of our arrogant behavior, because of our personal interest, we don't know. But when you are put on trial, when you are facing imtihan, then you will manifest your essence and your moral problems. When Iblis was put on trial, then this arrogant behavior, he showed and expressed his behavior. So this reflection or expression is due to the trial, and this is happening with us. So several times I have already seen in my communities that apparently the people are very good, but they have some issues. They may have jealousy, they may have enmity, they may have prejudice attitude, they may have takappur, they may have proud or feeling of proud. So, but in normal circumstances you will think that they are good. But when there is a trial for them, then you will see that no, these are the issues. He will reflect these problems, moral issues. So this is why it is also important for all of us to evaluate and revisit us, to see that whether we are having these problems or not. Otherwise, several times it happened. For example, if you are my friend, so you are very good to me. But once you have become my enemy, it happened to me several times, and also with you, and this is happening in our society. Then when you have become enemy, then you will show your inner problems against me. For example, I'm just saying about myself. If I am your friend, I will be the same. If I am your enemy, for example, I disagree with you and we have already disconnected from each other, again, I will not have any conspiracy theory against you. I will not harm you. I would again respect you. This is our morality. If we are friends together and we are good to each other, this is not an art. Art is when you dislike me, when you don't accept me, when we have already, broken up, then you have to show that you are a good person, you are a moral person, you are a decent person, you are not having substandard statements or whatever it is. So this is what I wanted to say from here, that we need to understand that sometimes we have these problems, but we don't know ourselves. Maybe the last one, but another interesting aspect is the issue of empathy and reasoning. Now, this is the last issue of the day, but this is very interesting. Can you see? Yeah. So, what is empathy and compassion? Empathy and compassion mean that I have this ability to share with you your feelings, your problems. I understand your feelings. Exactly. We are on same page. If we are not on same page, then I will not help you. For example, you are deprived, you are in need of me, you are, for example, asking something from me, you are distressed, and I don't understand your feeling. When I don't understand your feeling and we are not on the same page, I will not help you, because my feelings are different, your feelings are different. So empathy and compassion, this is what you have already attended my lecture. I had a detailed lecture at Azhara last Thursday about empathy and compassion in the Quran, or maybe like this, there was a topic. So this is now only I just took this slide only from my lecture, that because it was related to our today's lecture. So I would like to say sometimes empathy plays a decisive role. For example, we have if we go back to Pakistan, other countries like India, so there is lot of disagreement and dispute between Sunni and Shia. They are killing each other. So this is my experience. So I had a highest post also there. I was just doing job and I had a lot of obligations and I had an interaction. So for example, there is an alim or scholar from other faith, and he is enmity, he has enmity, and he has a prejudice attitude. But because you are not in touch with him, you are not friend with him. If you are friendly, if you are, for example, always meeting each other, you are always have a good time to each other, you have empathy, you have compassion, then his reasoning power will change. He will change his worldview about you. Not, there are two ways. For example, you are against me. So I will tell you that you are against my faith. Why? I will give you a logical argument. But sometimes there is another way. Another way is not because you don't want any logical argument from me. Because these logical arguments do not work here.
You know,
but akhlaq.
Is it because the stereotype we have it about the other person?
Sometimes we have.
About the stereotype we have it for the other person, the one.
Yeah. We have from both sides. Uh-huh. Sometimes we have this problem, from other have this problem. This is the same issue. But what I am going to say that, for example, you have problem with me, okay? Or maybe I have problem with you. The issue is same. Now I have two ways. One is to tell you that these are 1, 2, 3, 4 are reasons that you have to change your mindset. You have misunderstanding. You have misconceptions. So you will say, okay, your arguments are not enough to convince me. But I have another way. The way is not to talk about this issue. I will become your friend. I will have a friendly relations with you. Then empathy and compassion. If I'm helping you practically, if we are always in the mainstream and we are not isolated from each other. So that, this is what I'm saying here. That sometime this empathy and compassion and our friendly relation and peaceful coexistence. This is what we are talking about, interfaith harmony. What is interfaith harmony? So when we are sitting with Christians, with the people who are Jews, for example, and Buddhists, so when you will not sit with them, then you will have a lot of misconceptions. When you sit with them, you have friendly relations, then you believe that you will change your mindset. Because we don't want to come close to each other. We need to work on this issue. So this is what we say, that empathetic behavior not only makes you morally decent person, it also affects your thinking and rational behavior. So now our thinking and rational behavior, sometimes there are academic grounds, logical grounds, and sometimes because of good moral attitude. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he showed his morality, his ethics, that he is truthful, he is Amin, he is Sadiq. So after 40 years, then people, this aspect basically affected last, that people accepted him and followed him because of his moral behavior. Not because of logical or philosophical argument. He was not able to convince them at that time. Because of his morality, because of his ethics, so he gained their trust. So trust is very important. If you are trustworthy, then you will really accept each other, you will tolerate each other, even you will feel there is no difference between us. You will see, okay, I am Muslim, you are Christian. But the essence is same. The soul and spirit of religion is same. And you will be able to see the same spirit everywhere. So, thank you.
Thank you. So, do you have any questions?
Any question? Any question?
About the self-interest, like, is it?
Okay, you think. So, thank you very much for coming. And hopefully, I would like to take up another beautiful issue about, and this is also happening in our society, especially in the university environment, about ethical aspects, issues. For example, whether ethical issues are relative or not. How we can say that, for example, right and wrong about ethical issues. So I don't know, I will just discuss, but I am willing to take up this issue next week. Thank you very much. So kind of. So